kicks it out. Chalmers to James. Box the jump shot.
Well, I'll be. Is that who I think it is? Come over here. Nathaniel, how the heck are you? It's been ages. Come over here. Come on. Bring it in. It's been too long. How are you? What do you think it's been? It's got to be 10 years now, hasn't it?
10 years too many, if you ask me. And I see you even brought your own knife. It's a shame. The wife and I, we just sat down for dinner. You just missed it. Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't you go ahead, you bring yourself on back here tomorrow night around 6 o'clock. We'll go all out. We'll prepare a big meal, and if you're lucky, I'll even see if Rhonda won't lead us in a game
of Scattergories. It'll be a ball. How does that sound?
Huh.
Looks like someone forgot this on their way in, Mr. Clumsy. You haven't changed a bit, have you? Here you go. Anyways. Well, we'll be seeing you again tomorrow, all right?
Thanks for stopping by, Nath. Don't be a stranger.
What's up, everybody? How's it going? Before we dive into things, I do want to let you all know that Grant and I, we did work out all of our differences from the whole, you know, trying to murder me thing. He came back over for dinner the next day. We worked the whole thing out. It was a grand old time. But today we are talking about loving your enemies, which Jesus talks about in a Sermon on the Mount. And here's what he says in Matthew 5, verse 43 and 44. He says, "You've heard that it was said that love your neighbor and hate your enemies. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." Jesus also says earlier in verses 38 and 39, "You've heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if someone slaps you in the right cheek, offer him the other." And this is just an absolute mind grenade from Jesus. Like, up until this point in the earth's history, it's been taught an eye for an eye. Like, you hurt me, I hurt you. If you hate me, then I hate you. And then Jesus comes out and he says this? Like, don't retaliate, but instead love them? Like, what do you mean love them? I hate them. I don't know about you, but loving my enemies is not always my first reaction. In fact, let me be honest with you for a second. A lot of times, I don't want to love my enemies. In my worst moments, I want to hurt them, or I want to gossip about them, or undermine them, or do whatever it takes to genuinely make them pay. And in my better moments, I just simply want to ignore them and bottle up those frustrations so that way I can just gloat about being the better person. Do any of you relate to that? Unless you're super duper holy or something, I think we all have those moments in life where we just default to an eye for an eye, where we want to hold a grudge. We really want the satisfaction of justice, right? And then Jesus goes all, love your enemies, and we're just kind of like, yeah, okay, Jesus, sure, I'll love my enemies right after I fly to the moon. It's a chunk of the Bible that I think oftentimes we just wish wasn't there, but it is. So what do we do with it? Like, what does that mean for us? To put it simply, I think we should probably start loving our enemies. You're like, oh, wow, Jeff, thanks for the tip. You spent a lot of time thinking that one up. But let's take a second to talk about the why. Like, why would Jesus say that? Why is it here? And I think it's really because at one point, we were enemies of God. We were undeserving of forgiveness and completely deserving of wrath and judgment. but he saved us. And so it's pretty hard for us to accept the love of Jesus and expect all of the benefits that come along with that and then turn around and just be jerky McJerk faces to all the others around us who are in need of forgiveness themselves. I think a lot of times we picture ourselves as perfect and then completely forget about our own imperfections. And so if we can understand that we don't deserve the forgiveness that's offered to us, we're then able to extend mercy to others who need forgiveness themselves. Because mercy isn't mercy if it's earned. We received mercy that we didn't earn. And that should really be able to allow us to extend mercy to others and those who have hurt us. But that doesn't mean like you have to be best buddies with this person. I mean, forgiveness does not equal trust. If somebody hurts you, that's unhealthy and it should be avoided. If someone comes up to you in anger and just punches you in the face like a crazy person, you probably shouldn't be hanging out within arm's length of them. And instead of retaliating in a short-tempered fit of rage, whether that's internally or externally, you can forgive them. You can pray for them. You can extend mercy to them and be a living example of Jesus Christ to a person who obviously needs a better picture of him. And not in a boastful or arrogant, no, I'm better than you way, but in a way that shows the love of God to a hurting person. There's so much freedom that comes through forgiveness. Because instead of holding on to vengeance and anger and bitterness, it's no longer your burden to carry. We're not meant to hold the weight of a grudge. So hand your vengeance over to God. Like, don't worry about the weight of justice, of getting back at them or getting even. Like, that's God's job. And when you can look at someone who has wronged you and say, I forgive you. And I can do that because of how God has forgiven me through Jesus. When you can do that, you can experience freedom through loving your enemies. Our job is to forgive, to give it to God, to release the burden of anger and bitterness. It turns out, Jesus knows what he's talking about.